Let's go back to the Senate. Linda and Adele are with Representative Miro Quimbo, the spokesperson of the prosecution team. Linda, Adele.
Right, Gigi, thank you. Well, the earliest development in the impeachment trial on day six of the impeachment trial of CJ Corona is, of course, the filing by the prosecution of their legal memorandum explaining why Article 2 of the impeachment trial should include two other elements, namely the failure of the CJ to disclose his alleged properties as well as accumulation of ill-gotten wealth. And to tell us more about it, we have Congressman Quimbo. Good morning, sir.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good afternoon.
So tell us a little bit about the contents of the legal memorandum.
Well, essentially, the legal memorandum talks about the nature of the SALN and that the SALN is intrinsically related to the ITR. Much as the defense has been wanting to prevent the ITR from coming out, we have to remember that those two documents are interrelated. What you actually file in your SALN, which you file every year, is principally based on the wealth that you're accumulating, including the assets that you have based on your income. And your income is determined by your ITR. I mean, that's the main barometer. And even without going through the discussion yet on whether we can present evidence pertaining to ill-gotten wealth about the children, but as far as the Chief Justice is concerned, his ITR is intrinsically related and completely interrelated with the SALN. You do not file your SALN without looking at your ITR. So those are the two things that we need to be able to present, because much as the defense has been saying that the SALN is simply a matter of filing and disclosing, they're forgetting the fact that the main ingredient of the SALN is that the disclosure must be truthful. It must be based on, that's why you put it under oath. And that's what we're saying here, is that it will clearly show that just on the base of the SALN from 2003 up to 2010 that his asset base actually tripled. From 7.9 million, it went up to 23.9 million. That needs to be explained. That's why we need to look at the ITR. Of course, the defense is doggedly resisting that, and we cannot understand why we cannot make that presentation.
So essentially, you're saying that for you to also establish whether he filed his SALN properly,
yes,
or not, is you
yes.
also have to look into the matter of, are there any properties that he did not disclose in his SALN?
That is one of non-disclosure. And even for those, let's just assume he declared everything. We will need to look at his income tax return for us to be able to know if in fact there is a, if his properties are disproportionate to his income. That's what the SALN is for. The SALN is not an empty rhetorical document that you just file. It is a measure for people to see if a public officer is in fact enriching himself. How do we determine that? We determine if he has acquired assets that cannot be supported by his income. And the income is determined by his ITR.
Adele and I were looking at the legal memorandum that the prosecution has filed earlier. And I guess what struck me even as a non-lawyer is that you were citing a case, Republic versus the Sandigan Bayan.
That is correct.
Of which the ponente or the author of the decision was the Chief Justice himself.
Yes.
And what is the relevance of this particular case insofar as your arguments on the scope of Article 2?
That case falls absolutely squarely on the issue of ill-gotten wealth. We can debate about the fact whether we have alleged it sufficiently in our complaint or not. We will, to the very end, we will say that we did, and it's you can see it, it's replete all over the verified complaint. But even by his own words, his own ponentia in the case involving the Marcos wealth, he clearly said that in determining the SALN and determining the income, we cannot be bound by too many technicalities. What is important here is that we be able to determine if, in fact, an individual has acquired wealth that is beyond his legitimate income. Those are the words of the Chief Justice, like what we always say, what is sauce for the goose should be sauce for the gander. If this is the standard that he imposed based on jurisprudence he himself wrote, why can't we use the same for him? I think it's a case of double standard, if I may say so, if we, the defense keeps on insisting that we cannot apply that.
One of the things that perhaps was not sufficiently explained to the public was that you filed not only a memo, but also in opposition to their motion to quash. And I'd like you to perhaps explain a little bit the issue that was raised by the defense, that the testimony in regard the assets belonging to the children. The defense are claiming that it is irrelevant. Could you comment on the claim of the defense?
Well, obviously the defense has seen or is anticipating already what the contents of the ITR of the children are. Mm-hmm. One of the children, the couple actually bought 42 million pesos worth of real estate based on titles that we've already submitted as evidence. 42 million pesos in a span of 5 years. And obviously that that buying spree needs to be supported by some income. And I am certain that they have discussed it with the children and have seen the actual ITR that they've submitted. Mm-hmm. And that the ITR probably does not in any way support that. And they will fight every nook and cranny to be able to stop the submission of the ITR, because it will clearly be damaging to the theory of the case of the defense. And it will clearly establish, as far as we are concerned, that not only was the Chief Justice amassing ill-gotten wealth, but he was actually using, unfortunately, even his family, mm-hmm. in terms of concealing or hiding this ill-gotten wealth.
Mm-hmm. Of course, you're referring to, there's some, together with the explanation on Article 2, you have filed an opposition to the motion of the defense to quash the subpoena issued to BIR Commissioner Kim Henares. Are you expecting that Commissioner Kim Henares will be presented on the witness stand today? I think, can you give us the lineup of witnesses mm-hmm. that will be presented today?
Well, we have a set of witnesses. We have 7 witnesses that were ready to testify yesterday, including BIR Commissioner Kim Henares. So we're hoping that we are certain that the defense will not give up so easily. They will fight every possible means to prevent her from taking the stand. But mm-hmm. in the end, I think the senators will see that the pursuit of truth, just like what Senator Miriam said, if there's nothing to hide, why don't we bring out the evidence? Mm-hmm. And anyway, the defense will always have the opportunity to dispel it. But the public will not lend credibility to the process mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. if evidence is not allowed to be ventilated. Mm-hmm. We can't go too far. That's the second envelope experience, and I think it will only strengthen the institution of the Senate if we allow a ventilation of all these evidence.
Mm-hmm. I think, speaking of the defense, let's isama na natin sa usapan. Let's bring into the discussion Attorney Karen Jimeno, one of the spokespersons for the defense. Attorney, have you seen the legal memorandum of the prosecution, and if you have your comments on it?
No, we haven't seen it yet today. I haven't seen it. And well, I guess we look forward to reading what they have to say about why the ill-gotten wealth should be covered by Article 2.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. But Adele?
Yeah, well, I raised that point to Congressman Quimbo. Would you expound on that point in your motion to quash in regard to the irrelevancy or relevancy of the properties of the children in regard to the impeachment case of Chief Justice Corona?
Well, this is just consistent with our point from the start, that if they really wanted to include the allegation of ill-gotten wealth, they should have made it very clear in their allegations when they filed the impeachment complaint. One of the basic requirements for our due process, which is enshrined in our Constitution, is that if you're accusing someone of something, even in civil cases, your allegations should be based on ultimate facts. It should be based on personal knowledge. This is found in our rules of pleading. And the way they allege the ill-gotten wealth under Article 2 is that it was only based on suspicions and accusations and reports, no personal knowledge. And even the senators were asking, why did you not include it in your caption? Article 2 clearly states it's failure to publicly disclose the SALN. Mm-hmm. So if you're discussing the ill-gotten wealth there, then why can you not just clearly put it there, mm-hmm, right? Mm-hmm. So it's hard not to think or perceive that maybe they did not have personal knowledge of these facts, mm-hmm. and what they're trying to carry out right now is a fishing expedition of mm-hmm. evidence that they never had from the start.
Mm-hmm. Fishing expedition. Congressman Quimbo, you might want to respond to that.
Well, I'd like to dispel the... It's clearly stated there. And in fact, when we said suspected and alleged, But we did allege a specific property that we saw at that point in time, the Bellagio property, which they have admitted. They have denied the allegations on ill-gotten wealth. So even from the standpoint of lawyers, the issues have already been joined. So as far as we're concerned, it's already clear. But be that as it may, I think what's important here is that they keep saying that evidence found after the filing of the complaint cannot anymore be allowed. That's preposterous. I mean, that's entirely divorced from basic court proceedings. Mm-hmm. Precisely, we issued the subpoenas because we could not get copies of the salen. So are you then saying that we will not file a case because we could not find and they resisted the request for the salens to be produced? Do we wait until such time that these documents are eventually ferreted out through a subpoena? That's precisely why we raised the matter. And I think, you know, even on the basis of the ponencia of Justice Renato Corona in Republic versus Sandigan Bayan, where he completely said the relationship of the SALN with the ITR as being intrinsic and being interrelated in terms of determining ill-gotten wealth. I don't call it a fishing expedition. You call that catching the fish by his mouth.
Speaking of catching the fish, well, I wanted to ask before we wrap up, Attorney Karen, well, I don't know if you've read it, but they've cited Republic versus the Sandigan Bayan, a ponencia of the Chief Justice himself, where he's supposed to have said, or he was quoted as saying that, you know, you set aside technicalities in the search for truth, and this particularly pertains to accumulation of ill-gotten wealth. What is your reaction to the fact na parang, you know, caught by his own mouth?
Yeah, no. Okay, first, with respect to the salen, and they were never preventing it from coming out. It's in fact one of our part of our evidence. That's why the defense marked it as exhibits. If they really had evidence of ill-gotten wealth based on the salens from the start, they could have just requested for the salens from the clerk of court of the Supreme Court, going through the normal procedure in the Supreme Court and bank resolution. And then with respect to this decision, we are not fighting just based on technicalities right now. The right to due process and the right to be informed of charges against the respondent is a very clear and basic right in our constitution that's not technical, that's substantive. So this is not really just a battle on technicalities. We have to oppose and object to evidence that we find irrelevant based on the allegations in the complaint.
Okay, it looks like it's going to be a raging debate this afternoon. We'd like to thank our guests, Attorney Karen Jimeno of the defense and Congressman Miro Quimbo of the